Thank you, Pippa. Hello, my name's Steph Diamonds-Veyer and I am a teacher, trainer and materials writer.
And I'm Virgil Yerubino and I manage teacher development courses at Cambridge English Language Assessment.
Today, we're going to share with you some ideas for improving writing by using digital tools. Let's begin our webinar by going through the aims of today's session. In this session, we'll be looking at writing and thinking about the features of good writing and how we can use digital tools to support learners with these. We'll look at some practical tools, including code readers, infographics, and mind map generators, and collaborative planning and writing tools. Here's a question. What skills do learners need to be successful writers? I'm going to show you some skills and I'd like you to think about which one your learners need most. The skills are understanding the goal, which means understanding what's required of them by the task and also for the level they're working at. Reviewing and editing, which is the ability to check work and identify areas for improvement. Producing a first draft, so being able to create that first text. Producing a final draft, which is polishing and making the text as good as it can be. Coming up with ideas, that is the initial brainstorm of content for the text. Organising ideas, which involves getting the ideas into a logical order. Having the motivation to write, so wanting to actually produce the text. Now, these skills are not in any kind of order, but which one do your learners need most? Which one do they struggle with? You can type your ideas in the chat box. So we'll give you a moment just to type out your ideas.
Let's have a look.
Motivation is coming up.
Of course. Organising ideas I see a lot.
Yep, somebody else has said all of them.
Yes, of course.
Organising again, yeah. A few people have mentioned drafting.
The first draft has come up, yeah.
A motivation again with lots of exclamation marks. Okay, I think we've pretty much got all of those coming up.
I think so, yeah.
So, let's have a look. Thank you very much. So, there are many different issues that learners face, and in today's webinar, we're going to look at each of these skills and ways in which digital tools can help learners. The way we teach writing tends to fall into one of two approaches, product or process. Here's what the product approach covers. When taking a product approach, we often look at how well students are able to produce specific sub-skills in writing, such as formatting appropriately, using mechanical aspects such as spelling and handwriting, and applying cohesive devices well. These can help students to understand the goal and produce their final draft. By taking a process approach, we work to ensure learners know how to plan according to the given purpose and to organise and draft their writing successfully. Both of these approaches have their place, but this webinar will focus mainly on the process of writing and how we can help learners at each stage by using digital tools. Speaking of digital tools, how much do you use technology to develop learners' writing skills? Have a look at the three choices on the screen and vote on the option that best describes what you do. So number one, yes, I use technology a lot. Number two, yes, sometimes, but I would prefer to use technology more and in different ways. Or number three, no, not very much. Okay, so
we've got some answers to the poll coming in already.
Yeah.
And it looks like it's almost evenly split between not very much and sometimes, but sometimes seems to be taking the lead place there.
So more on sometimes. A few people have said they use it a lot, but mainly the other two have taken the lead. So thank you very much for answering. And let's have a look. So writing is often seen as more demanding and less enjoyable than, for example, speaking. One of the skills we looked at earlier was having the most motivation to write, and digital tools can actually help with this, as we'll see. Before we do that, I'd like to make a very important general point about using digital tools for teaching and learning. When we use digital tools in teaching, we need to be certain that their use is beneficial, both for the learners and the teacher. Make sure that the digital activity supports the outcome, that you aren't just doing it because it's new or because it exists. The activity should also support the outcome effectively and efficiently. We'd accept that it takes time to set up a digital tool the first time you use it, but if it continues to be difficult to set up or run, it might be better to use other techniques. It isn't going to work if setting up a task takes longer than the learners spend completing it. With these golden rules in mind, let's consider our key skills for successful writing and how digital tools might help.
We'll begin with understanding the goal of writing. This means learners understanding what's required of them, both in terms of the task and of the outcomes. By outcomes, I mean the language used, the content, the communicative effect, and organisation of the text. I'm sure many of you will have recognised by now that I'm talking about the assessment criteria. Let's explore this with an example. Here's a task. You can see this task, and the sample answer as well, on your handout, Sample Writing. This task is to write an essay. The question asks the learner to write about pollution and damage to the environment, and if they feel these problems can be solved. This is a task set for B2 level learners. So let's have a look at a sample answer. This sample answer is also on the handout Sample Writing. Take a minute to read the answer. If you haven't already, you can download the handout using the link at the bottom of the screen. So I'll allow you a moment to read the answer. Now, think about the good qualities of this answer. What do you think the writer has done well? Remember, this is at B2 level. Here are three possible answers. They're also on your handout, Sample Writing, see Task A. Which of these options do you think best summarises the good points of the writing? Choose one, two, or three. Here are the options. Option one, relevant content, clear opinion, register appropriate, well organised with wide range of vocabulary and minimal errors. Or option two, relevant content, excellent grammar with no errors, well-linked paragraphs and coherent arguments with opinion stated. Or option three, clear opinion, well organised paragraphs, register appropriate, wide range of vocabulary and no errors. Please vote now.
We've already got lots of votes coming in, Virgil.
Fantastic.
So I think number one is in the lead. Number three was quite close, but it's dropping down a bit now.
Okay. Yeah, thanks very much for that. In fact, the correct answer is number one. The writing has relevant content to the task, expresses a clear opinion using appropriate register, is well organised and uses a wide range of vocabulary with minimal errors. The linking of the paragraphs could be improved, so it doesn't fit option two. It also has some errors in grammar and vocabulary, so doesn't match options two and three. These errors don't impede communication though, so this is a good level for Cambridge English First and would also be a good model to show students. This is a writing question, from the Cambridge English First writing paper. You can find the task, sample answer and feedback in the Handbook for Teachers via the Cambridge English website. We'll give you the link in a moment. Identifying these features of success is not just useful for teachers, but is an excellent way to help learners know what to aim for. A useful technique to give to help them improve is to give them lots of models of good writing, whether email, report, review, essay, or similar. This helps them to understand the features of different genres. You can also show them the criteria, which will be used to assess them, either for classwork or in a formal proficiency test. They can then understand more easily what's expected and where they need to improve, and they can start to use the criteria themselves. Of course, we can give handouts in class, but we can also use digital tools to exploit resources in different ways.
So if you want your students to use the task and answer and that we've just looked at, you can make it easy for them by giving them the links in a way that's accessible. The actual link to the Cambridge English First Handbook is on the slide. As you can see, it's long and difficult to copy. So instead, you could use a QR code. This is also on the handout, Sample Writing. You may already have a QR code reader on your phone or device. If not, it only takes a few moments to download a free app. Learners simply click on the app and scan the code. It can take them to a website, image, PDF, YouTube video, or similar. You can easily generate these codes using free online websites. They're very simple to use. We've put some QR codes on the handout for you to try out later. Or you could give them a shortened URL. Again, there are lots of free, easy to use internet sites to help you create these. This one is also on your handout. As you can see, it's easier and shorter than the original link. So, that's how you can make it easy for learners to access online models. But how could you use them? Well, as suggested, you could use them to provide models of different texts for learners to analyse. Essays, reviews, messages, anything you like. You could upload samples with annotations or questions for analysis too. You could put these on your own web page or a cloud-based platform for learners to download. We'll look at cloud-based platforms in more detail a little later. You can annotate the task with questions, encouraging learners to really think about the task and what they're being asked to do, or give them a set of questions they need to answer about the task. Alternatively, you could use QR codes and shortened URLs to set up a writing task. For example, if students are going to write a review of a film or some music, you could use the codes or shortened URLs to link them to trailers or music videos. If they have to write a discursive essay about the environment, you could link them to resources about the effects of pollution, or even to a web page or site you've set up with your own materials.
Now let's think about another of the skills for successful writers, coming up with ideas. A common complaint among learners is that they don't know what to write and find it difficult to think of ideas. One way that teachers deal with this in the classroom is to encourage learners to collaborate, brainstorming ideas together. Digital tools can also help learners to collaborate more effectively outside of the classroom as well. Firstly, websites can provide a useful stimulus for learners. Sites such as TED.com have thousands of talks on different topics, including interactive transcripts that learners can follow. There is now a whole family of resources, including TED-Ed, which has short educational animations with lesson plans attached. Teachers can type in a keyword such as pollution and give learners a shortened URL or QR code so they can access one or more of the related talks. There's an example on the slide and also on the handout Sample Writing. TED also has a Twitter feed, which has lots of interesting discussions, and your students, if old enough, can follow TED on Twitter or share ideas via this type of social media. This will keep them in touch with current discussions, giving them better ideas for their own essays, but will also give them writing practice by interacting on social media. Another site full of interesting videos and discussions with a less academic tone is Sol Pancake, which links through to videos on YouTube. This is full of topics and ideas that might be useful starting points for writing work. There are many resources on the Cambridge English website, specifically designed for learners. You can find the link on the handout Useful Websites. These resources offer content that has been graded for level. For example, here you can see a listening activity aimed at B1 to B2 level, reviewing a theatre performance. This could be a good starting point for learners who are going to write a review of their own.
Cambridge English Language Assessment has also just launched its new digital teacher site, where you can find more ideas about how to use the digital tools in the classroom. Perhaps you know of other helpful sites that keep students well informed, give them fresh ideas, and provide some interesting topics. Write into the text box now any sites that you think are worth sharing. Okay, so any interesting websites with content, maybe, with content that students can look at to generate ideas for writing.
Yeah.
So often that is difficult for them.
Yes.
So have we got anything coming in? Mine's just updating now.
Okay.
National Geographic, I've used that. That's an excellent one. It's got some very nice audio-visual materials on it, which is great.
Yeah, BBC Learning English, also a fantastic resource.
Yes, a few people are mentioning that. Somebody else has mentioned IELTS.net, which is, I guess, more aimed at an exam.
Yeah.
Prep. British Council, of course, yes.
Always good. And good suggestion of authentic materials just from the web in general and news.
CNN, etc., yes. Yeah. Okay, there's lots of people mentioning the BBC Language Academy. So look at the chat box and you'll be able to see other people's ideas for content websites. So that's great. Thank you very much for all of those ideas. It will help learners to spend some homework time on websites such as these before they start working on their writing. They'll feel more confident about the topic in the writing task when they use it. This brings us to the next skill for successful writers: having the motivation to write. Learners often feel that the kind of writing we ask them to do in class bears no relation to anything they write outside of school or in their normal lives. Increasing confidence by giving learners ideas through digital media is one way to help. But let's take a minute now to look at some other tools which can help in different ways. One way to motivate learners is to make the outcome something that appeals to them. There are digital tools that can help us to do this, using their own ideas, images and materials, and even working collaboratively in groups. For example, they could create mini books or comic strips. There are some free and paid for apps online which they can share with the class. Allowing learners the freedom to create their own content and use their own ideas without the constraints of a task can help them to gain confidence in their writing skills. Learners can create imaginary social media pages about topics they have studied, a book or film they like, or a person they admire. They can then interact with likes, comments, and postings. They can also work collaboratively to create newspaper pages, including photographs, headlines, and text. These could be about a local event, something happening in the school, or related to a topic they're studying in class. Some examples of websites for these tools are given on the handout useful websites, but you can find others online by searching through your browser. These are just examples. Find genres that appeal to your learners, and you'll almost certainly find an online tool which will enable them to produce a text.
Let's go back and consider another of our key skills for successful writers. We've talked about motivation and coming up with ideas, but what about organising those ideas? Organisation is one of the assessment criteria used in assessing writing for Cambridge English exams, and we all know how important organisation is in a well-written text. What have you observed in your learner's writing? There are four options on the screen. Choose the one that best describes your learner's approach to organisation. Here are the options. 1. They only have one or two ideas, which they repeat. 2. They have good ideas, but they jump from one to another and back again. 3. They try to organise their ideas, but it's not very successful. Or 4. Their writing is usually well organised. I'll give you some time to respond to the poll.
So for the first three, seem to be the most demanding.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've got, it's fairly even between choice 1, 2, and 3, actually, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it's a really even spread.
So far fewer of you saying that writing is usually well organised. Only 4.3% now.
Yep. And about a third each or so. For the other options.
Yeah. Mm.
That's very interesting.
So fairly spread out problems.
Absolutely. I mean, options 1 to 3 are all problems that learners can have when writing. And often it's because they are too quick to start writing their text and aren't willing to take time to plan their writing, which can lead to writing that lacks coherence or flow. They need to record their ideas and organise them into a coherent plan. By allowing learners to use digital tools collaboratively, you encourage them to complete this stage of the writing process more effectively. This approach not only allows mixed ability classes to work well together, but also enables learners to see the importance of planning. It also makes planning more engaging for those learners who are good at it already. Let's go through the problems and identify some solutions. Let's take the first problem. Repeating the same idea. We've already looked at digital tools which can help learners to generate ideas, but they also need to have a way to record the ideas they come across. This is something which web-based applications, such as online bulletin boards, can do very well, and there are plenty to choose from. You can find examples on your handout, useful websites. The screenshot on the slide is from one site, Digo, which allows you to bookmark web pages and texts, as well as highlight them and annotate them. On sites like this, learners can copy links, pieces of text, photographs, video clips, and more onto a single web page. They are very visual and can be manipulated. These pages can be shared among a group of students, or even the whole class. So before writing, learners can have the task of producing a page of ideas which they share with others. Another problem is that once learners have collected their ideas, they need to organise them into some kind of structure so that they avoid jumping from one idea to another. Individuals have different ways in which they like to plan. Some people like visual depictions and diagrams, others like lists, and some find spidergrams or mind maps helpful. So it's worth spending some time exploring different planning techniques and encouraging learners to choose the one they find suits them best. Let's look at some of the tools. Some learners like diagrams and flowcharts. This is an example of an online tool which allows learners to create their own charts and show connections between ideas. This is key in helping learners to write better structured texts. They need to identify which areas and ideas are related, and in which way. The link to this site is on the handout, Useful Websites. For learners who like spidergrams or mind maps, There are free online tools for this too. The image on the screen is an example of a mind map about music. You can see that the map can include visuals and learners can connect related ideas or add examples. Our third problem was that learners aren't always successful in organising their ideas.
Well, in part this is practice. Planning is planning a text is a skill that needs to be learned. So teachers need to spend some class time on this and provide structured activities. These can be done online. For example, the whole class could produce an online bulletin board with ideas, and then individual learners could create their own plan using their preferred method. All of these tools can be shared, so then each learner can share their plan with the teacher or with one of their peers, and they can comment on each other's plans. Alternatively, learners could work in groups to create their plans, or the teacher could set up a map and invite learners to add to it or reorganise the elements. Then they can download the final result to use when they write their first draft. Let's move on now to talk about writing that first draft. If you've worked with learners on understanding what's required of them, coming up with ideas and planning and organising those ideas, writing the first draft should be a lot easier. And I'm going to surprise you now, because I'm going to suggest that you might want to ask your learners to write out their first draft by hand. Why do you think it might be useful for learners to use traditional handwriting to do this? So we're talking about digital tools, but still a place for writing by hand. Let's see what people say.
Yeah, do put your answers in the chat box.
So people are still talking about different sites they're using. And
oh, yeah, well, a good point from Janice there. Avoid plagiarism.
Yes, yes. Of course. Somebody else has mentioned spelling. That's Eleanor. Margarita has said it might be quicker. Possibly. To help them keep concentrated.
That's a good point.
Yeah, so they don't whiz off and do other things online that they shouldn't be doing.
Absolutely, yeah.
I think we've all suffered that in class.
Yeah.
Focus on the class. So, lots and lots of really interesting ideas here. Here are my reasons for suggesting this. Firstly, in writing by hand, learners won't be able to use the computer to do automatic checks on their spelling and grammar, as a couple of you mentioned. They have to do this for themselves. So they will need to think more carefully about the language and the spelling they're using. This is also more likely to make them think about the suggestions that spell checkers make, which are not always correct. Secondly, learners often have to handwrite in exams, so it is important that they practice doing this and make sure that their handwriting is as legible as possible. And finally, not all types of writing suit being produced on computers or devices, such as notes or lists, so learners need to practice these as well. That said, there are digital tools which can help the writing of the first draft.
So one of these is online dictionaries, such as this one, the online Cambridge Dictionary. This is a great tool if students want to check information about a word, check how it's used and common collocations, or find synonyms and other related words. This can help learners to expand their vocabulary range and accuracy. It can also be really useful later in the writing process when editing, which I'll talk about in a moment. Up to now, we've assumed that learners will write their draft on their own, but as we've already seen, collaboration is made easier with digital tools, and I've got a tool I'd like to introduce you to. This is an infographic. You can also see this example on your handout using infographics. Infographics work with learners because they're used to multimodality. In other words, they are used to processing lots of different media simultaneously. Not just static pages, but a mix of text, images, and audio-visual material. Infographics can represent complex ideas, and using infographics tunes into learners' cognitive approaches and also engages those put off by the idea of writing text only. The ready-made infographic here is about learning a foreign language. How could you use this to develop your learners' writing skills? Write your ideas in the text box.
Yeah, so it's a lovely infographic, very colourful, lots of information.
It is, yeah.
Quite nicely divided into sections as well.
So it is. And it's amazing how much information you can get into a simple graphic like this.
Yeah, and I think students are very much focused on that kind of way of looking at information nowadays.
They are, yeah.
So Simonette has suggested it could be used as a prompt for writing, obviously. Yeah,
absolutely.
Let's see what other people are saying about it. Lots of information, Rosanna says.
Yeah, of course.
You could compare areas or several areas. So, yeah, it's very visually obvious.
I like a comment from Chan that it's stimulating the mind. Absolutely.
It certainly does. So yeah. They are using their kind of critical thinking skills.
Yes.
As well. Synthetic text is mentioned. Visually attractive from Emma.
Well, and they important. Understand.
Yes. It makes them more interested in doing the writing, I think.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. So, thank you very much. I'm going to share some ideas I had about how you could use this as part of a collaborative writing activity. Learners could pick out key ideas and plan paragraphs, giving them practice in identifying key information and in organising it. Learners could be allocated different sections of the chart and write it into a full paragraph. They could then share their paragraphs and give feedback to each other. Together, they could then structure the paragraphs into a complete text, adding linkers and working on referencing to make the text coherent. This could also work as an information gap, where learners could summarise elements of the chart and the rest of the class could then identify which part they have summarised. If each section of the infographic is seen as a potential paragraph, the learners could practice writing topic sentences for each section. They can share these and then add evidence or examples to expand their ideas. So, tools like this have many uses and help to provide stimulus for learners' writing. For those learners who find writing a text difficult, there are also websites which allow you to make your own infographics. We've listed some of these on the handout Useful Websites for you to explore after the webinar. Learners can use the visuals to support their writing, gradually moving towards more text and fewer graphics. You'll have noticed that I've been talking about a first draft. One of the key skills for successful writing is being able to review and edit your work. So let's discuss that now.
So, reviewing and editing are crucial in writing. Think about when you write an important email. Do you send it without reading it through, improving it and checking it for silly mistakes? I know I don't. In a second language, reviewing and editing is even more important, but teachers don't always give it the attention it needs. So, how do you feel about reviewing and editing writing work? There are four options on the screen. Choose the one that best describes how you feel about reviewing and editing writing with learners. So here are the options. The first one is that I trust my learners to review and edit their work before they hand it in. Number two, I mark up mistakes and possible areas for improvement for my learners, but I'm not sure how many of them they actually improve their work. Number three is I've never tried asking learners to review each other's work as I'm not sure that they would give each other useful feedback. And number four, I don't have enough time to spend in class on reviewing and editing writing work. Okay, let's see how we're doing.
Well, there's a clear consensus, I would say, on this one.
With yep.
about 80% of people saying I mark up mistakes and possible areas for improvement, but I'm not sure how many of them actually improve.
Well, that can be a worry, can't it? It's interesting that the focus there is largely on the teacher to be doing all of the the hard work and the reviewing. So, in fact, there are different ways that learners' work can be reviewed. They can give the text to a teacher who can suggest improvements or indicate mistakes. They can have their work peer-reviewed, usually with some kind of guidance, or they can use a checklist to review their own work. Each is useful and can be supported by digital tools. Let's see if some of the ideas I'm going to give you can help you to feel more confident about the review process. One of the great tools for teachers to emerge from the internet is the cloud-based platform. These platforms allow anyone to write a text online in a word processing document or program. The text is then stored in the cloud or online, so anyone can access it from anywhere. There is a range of these available for free. Check the handout useful websites for some suggestions. Once you've created and saved a text in the cloud, you can share it with other people. They can add to it, write notes on it, or comment on it. There are lots of ways that we can exploit this in our writing training. Can you think of some ideas now and type them into your text box? So cloud-based platforms, lots of them. Mm. Do have a look at the handout if you're asking about the tools we've been using. Let's see what people are saying so far.
Okay.
So people are talking about using Google Docs, mind mapping, and then rewriting after correction.
Writing a mini saga is very useful, says Simonette. It's interesting.
Yeah. So Google Docs being mentioned a lot as a way for students to share their... Somebody else has mentioned Shobi, which is very good.
Mm-hmm.
Edmodo, Padlet. So we've got lots of other tools being suggested. Do look at the website. So we're looking for ideas for how they can work on collaborative correction and reviewing. I can see some of you already use tools in your teaching, but here are a few ideas of ours. So using some of the sites you've suggested, you could add template documents for completion. This might provide a framework for the students to fill in. And this would be useful for learners who are less confident or who are learning to write in a genre that's new to them. As the learners grow in confidence, the template can become more of a skeleton or structure which learners use to organise their ideas. You can upload a task and ask learners to plan their answer together in small groups before they write the text in full. You can supply the structure of the answer and ask learners to work in groups to supply the contents for each paragraph before they write the text in full. You can provide an answer with errors for students to spot and correct. These could be areas you've been working on in class. They should reflect a range of the outcomes learners are expected to reach and not be just grammatical or vocabulary errors. Finally, learners can write their drafts and then share them with a small group who give feedback by suggesting improvements or identifying errors. Again, the learners need to be aware of the expectations and think about content, communication and organisation as well as language. We've talked a bit about how you can monitor your learners' editing using online tools, but what about encouraging self-review?
Yeah, by using word processing tools, such as tracking changes or highlighting text, teachers and learners can give and receive feedback on their writing. The teacher can monitor this quite easily and check what learners are doing in response to the feedback. You might want to provide them with a marking key to use. For example, when making feedback notes, they could write WW for wrong word, P for punctuation, and so on. If all students use this regularly, it can become a very effective tool and a good habit. On the slide, you can see a screenshot of the new Cambridge Digital Teacher website, where you can find detailed training on how to use these platforms for feedback. The link is on the handout, Useful Websites, as well. You can use simple online scheduling tools, which are usually used to set up meetings, to encourage self-review. These are free and easy to use. There are several links on the handout Useful Websites. The screenshot on the slide is of Doodle. Normally, the organiser sets up the poll with dates, and the participants insert their names and indicate their availability. However, instead of dates, you can include areas that you would like students to review, creating a sort of checklist. Learners can identify if they think they have done this well or if they need to improve by adding a tick into the features they are happy with. Or alternatively, learners can do this for each other's work. In class, they can then discuss what they think they could improve and how. If you feel that time is your enemy, and you would struggle to find time to work on reviewing and editing, there is a tool for you too. The tool, which is called Write and Improve, also encourages learners to develop some autonomy and get into the habit of practicing additional writing at home, editing it and correcting it. The link to this is on the handout Useful Websites. Write and Improve is free for students to use. There's a whole set of tasks for different levels. For example, here you can see some beginner level tasks. The learner simply chooses a task and types their answer. The site tells them when they have written enough text, and they can then click on check to get some feedback. The feedback highlights their text to guide the student to make improvements. They can rewrite and resubmit as many times as they want to see if they have improved their work. There are many benefits to working in this way. Can you suggest some? Write into the text box now.
Okay, let's have a look.
And it's an amazing tool, Write and Improve, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think time for marking is a really big demand on most teachers, yeah. And any kind of additional practice. Obviously, you need a variety of feedback, including from the teacher.
Yes.
But anything additional can help.
Yeah.
People here seem to agree as well.
Absolutely, yeah. It's student-centred, says Marie-Louise. I think that's absolutely right.
People are mentioning self-assessment here, autonomy, very useful tool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent tool to try. It is, and it is very student-centred. I think it does encourage students to take a little bit of responsibility for their own learning and additional practice.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks. These are great ideas. Here are some of the advantages we think the tool offers. It gives individual feedback, so the learner can work on their own specific problems. It teaches learners to work autonomously, as you said, without relying on the teacher. This means they will become more independent and effective in their writing, and also means the teacher isn't overloaded with marking. It is also a tool that learners can use at their own pace, at home, which means it works well if you have mixed ability classes.
That's the end of our presentation. I hope you've got lots of ideas to take away with you. Let's think about what we've discussed today. So we've considered the skills for successful writing, which include understanding what the features of good writing are, the goal. We looked at ways to help learners with all stages of writing, from feeling motivated to write and generate ideas, to organising these ideas and creating a text. We've talked about reviewing and editing, which always needs to consider all of the outcomes. And throughout the webinar, we've shown you digital tools to help with all of these things. Don't forget that links to lots of useful websites are on the handout, Useful Websites. In a moment, we'll answer your questions, so do send in your questions now so that we can start reading through them. Let's now answer some of the questions that have been suggested by some of you. Just a quick comment, lots of you have been asking, well, where can I find the tools that you've been talking about? We didn't actually list them on the slides, but if you go to your handout, you'll find lots of the sites used to create the various things we showed you. So after the webinar, do go away and explore those and have a look at how they work. One person asked about the QR codes, so Virgil, maybe you'd like to answer that. So they liked the idea, but they said, well, how do you actually do it? And it is very simple, isn't it?
It is very simple to use them, absolutely. A QR code is just that square image in which is contained the information for instance, a URL to go to. So if you've got a URL of a web page or something like that, you can go online to find any QR code generator. If you just search for QR code generator on Google, you'll find any number of free websites that will create those images for you. You will paste the URL to the site in there and it will generate that QR code as an image. And then you can use that image wherever you want to, on a slide, you can print it out. And then learners or whoever you want to will be able to use their phones to scan that image. The phone needs to have a QR code reader app installed on it. Again, those are free and there are lots of them available. And they just use the app to scan the code and then it will put that URL onto the phone.
And they're very, very quick to do it. It's literally two clicks. You put in your URL, click, and it creates the image. So it's super fast to use if you're a busy teacher, and students absolutely love them. Those of you who like doing things like running dictations, you can do a QR code reading running dictation by pinning things around the wall. So lots of variations using traditional techniques with more modern techniques as well. So good question there, thank you for that.
Thank you.
What else shall we look at?
There's an interesting question from Listia, who said, at what age should digital tools be introduced to students, and should younger and primary school students be introduced to digital tools?
Well, my take on it is absolutely, yes. Mm. I think obviously with young learners, you have to be much more careful about supervising what they're accessing and how they're doing it.
Of course.
So I'd encourage that to happen in the classroom rather than outside of the classroom. But there are lots and lots of very nice sites and tools for younger learners. And I think, you know, from primary upwards, children are constantly on digital tools. So it's a really good idea to get them used to associating it with learning as well as play.
Absolutely.
I don't know if you agree. I also think nowadays we talk about 21st century skills. Digital literacy is an important part of that. If you're using tools with younger learners in the classroom, you can include kind of educating them about safety online, about how to work with digital literacies effectively.
Exactly.
So from very early on, using very, very simple websites to start with, I think. What do you think?
I would say if it has a use, if it can be made useful for your teaching purpose, then there's no reason not to use it. And of course, youngsters will know how to use these sorts of devices. They'll have been growing up with them. So use it if it's useful.
Absolutely, absolutely. So what else shall we have a look at? We've got lots of questions coming in.
There was another interesting one here from Gabriella who asked about using digital tools in class, because she was thinking that she can mainly think of using them at home, digital tools that people can use at home. Mm. So what about that class versus at home?
Yeah, I mean, I use them for both. I think traditionally, sort of when we started using a lot of technology, 20 years ago now, it tended to be the kind of worksheets but done online, and so you'd ask people to do it at home. But now we have so many interactive tools. I mean, you can use all of the sort of websites we've been looking at, things like the the sort of fake media page. It's actually quite useful for students to work together in class creating those. But then stuff that we traditionally would have done in class, like the planning, lots of people worrying about planning of written work, we tend to associate that with collaborative work in class, can actually work really well using the mind mapping tools that you suggested at home. So I think for me personally, encouraging both is really important. Many students now do have digital devices that they bring into school, and making the most of those in class will actually often encourage them to engage with what they're doing. So yeah, for me, it's a balance.
It is, and I would add that one of the amazing things about digital tools is that they actually blur the boundaries between what's in the classroom and what's out of the classroom. They make that something that you can go between very easily. So they are worth thinking about, perhaps from the perspective of how is this useful, to say the same sort of thing again, as opposed to whether it's in the class or out of the class.
Absolutely. So somebody else is asking about Write and Improve. A few people have asked whether there are tools to use with beginners, and Write and Improve does have some very low level tasks on there.
Yes.
Which would be suitable. Somebody else has asked how accurate it is and whether they as teachers can get feedback as well as the students.
Well, it is a student-focused tool, and it's designed around that idea of autonomous learning. So, yes, if you want to use it yourself, but it is designed for a learner and not a sort of learner-teacher interaction.
And I think, part of the benefit of that tool is that, it really is in the students' hands, and it's up to them to put into it their own work. Who provides the feedback in Write and Improve? It's generated through software systems.
It is. It's a very clever piece of technology that actually analyses the text itself and uses our research over several years to understand what pieces of language occur at different levels on the CEFR A1 up to C2 to grade the language automatically.
Now, somebody else has asked, can we choose our own topics for that particular tool? Unfortunately, you can't, but there are so many of them covered. You will probably see, if you have a look, that there will be something close to a topic that you might want to look at. Also, remember that this is an additional practice tool, so you as a teacher will still want to give your own more detailed one-to-one feedback with your own students, but it will really help you to ease the load of marking but still get them to do lots and lots of extra writing at home. Okay, have we got time for anything else, or are we out of time? Somebody's mentioned differentiation. I mean, I think one of the good things about these tools is a lot of them are used by individuals. So in a sense, the differentiation is inbuilt in that it allows students to work to their own level or to focus on a particular area that's important for them to improve.
Absolutely. Personalisation and making things very specific to the learner is one of the benefits of digital tools.
Okay, so I think that's all we have time for. Thank you very much for attending today. We hope you found it useful, and we look forward to seeing you at our future webinars. The next webinar coming up is on using digital tools for continuous professional development on the 19th and 21st of June. Thank you.